7th pitch. Harper hits one in the air, left center field. Back it goes. Harper, the swing of his life. It is bedlam at the bank.
Swung on, hit, crushed, and the Phillies are going to lead it 4-0.
Now Harper sends one in the air, way back to right center.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Bell Ringers podcast, or welcome in. I don't know. Maybe it's your first time. But if it is your first time, you did not pick a very good time. Phillies just lost Game 7, the first Game 7 in the franchise's history, lost to the 84-win National League champion, Arizona Diamondbacks.
Well, you didn't have to say it like that.
Yeah, well, I told you, this isn't a good day. We usually have this house. Waving in the air. Today I've got the hood up. So I'll bring the hood down.
But it's just, you've said 84-win National League champion. And that really just shows you it only matters if you get in. It's all that matters. So with the Phillies last year, 87 wins, and they won the National League. It really only matters not what seed you are, how you get in, how it just matters if you get in. And if you get hot at the right time, and the Arizona Diamondbacks certainly got hot at the right time, and the Phillies, not so much.
Eagles are back, Ben.
The Eagles The Eagles are in full swing. They're playing well. The Sixers season starts tonight, which I don't know if it's certainly a positive.
Wait, tonight?
Tonight's the first game. Thursday night, 8 o'clock.
Really?
Yeah.
Is the crappy guy playing?
Harden? No.
I think I read about that. Didn't he he showed up to go on the plane and then they stopped him because they didn't have his security details and he just was like, I'm petty. Peace out, losers, and left?
Kinda. I can phrase it that way.
I have a couple Harden shirts. I'm going to burn all of them. Anyway, let's recap the season, Ben. So, started off rough. Series loss to the Texas Rangers. A series loss to the New York Yankees. Phillies started off 1-5. Is that correct?
They were 1-5 until they came into Citizens Bank Park on what was supposed to be April 6th. Got rained out. April 7th was the home opener. I was at that game. They won that game. And then it started to look a little better. They won that series. They lost the next series to the Miami Marlins. And then it would just continue with the bad start until Bryce Harper returned from Tommy John surgery in like mid-May. Things started to look better. May 20th, we had our event, the Philly Sports Reports event in Section 301 at the ballpark. That was exciting. And then the spiral just kept spiraling.
This is upside down, isn't it?
Yeah, you're holding the rally towel upside down. And then things started to get really good in what, June?
Yeah.
Yeah, June things picked up again like they did last year. And then July at the end, they started to look bad. And then August 4th, my good friend, the Philly captain, friend of the network, friend of the program. And then Jack Fritz, who I've met before, both kind of had the same idea at the same time for the standing ovation for Trey Turner. And that turned around this team, hit the most home runs and tied the most home runs in National League history in August with 59 home runs, most in a month of Phillies history. We thought they were going to win the World Series. They played bad, not great in September, but they clinched the National League in the final week of the season against Pittsburgh. And then we got into the postseason. Wild card, most dominant the Phillies really looked all season in two-game sweep of the Marlins. The NLDS, they faced the 102-win Braves, plus maybe the best offense in baseball. 104-win Braves, possibly the best offense in baseball history. They dominated them, won that series in four games. Then the MLCS got off to an incredible start at home in games one and two. They killed the Diamondbacks games three and four. We haven't spoke since game three, Colin, on the podcast. Game three, they lost on the walk-off, and that's really when this series changed, when Craig Kimbrel came in that last inning. And then game four, Craig Kimbrel blew the game again. Game five, the Phillies won. Game six, Phillies offense couldn't get anything going, and same story in game seven. But really, it's when your big guys, your four, Kyle Schwarber, Bryce Harper, Trey Turner, and Castellanos go a combined 1 for 32 in games six and seven, you're not going to win the game. This is flat out not going to happen.
Yeah, I'm going to go back. You made a point in the beginning about the Phillies getting off to a slow start, and I'll tell you, the way this season started kind of foreshadowed the way that it ended, and I didn't realize this until you mentioned it, right? 2022 ends. The Phillies were National League champions. The perennially dominant Houston Astros, they win the World Series. And, you know, while that was disappointing at the time, in hindsight, you know, we could recognize that that was a huge accomplishment for a Phillies team that has struggled since 2012. So that was, like I said, a huge accomplishment for them, right? They're coming off the biggest high they've had in 10 years. Plus, they lose five of the first six games of the season. They recover. They do really, really well in the postseason, beating the unanimously favored Atlanta Braves in the division series, have a two-game lead in Arizona, and lose four of five again. I mean, like I said, it really, really, really relates to the end of 2022. And in the beginning of 2023, going from an all-time high to a significant unforeseen low rapidly.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how low 2022 was when you look at that postseason, because we were just happy to be there. The last seed.
No, that's what I'm saying. I think you went off the...
I did.
Step aside, but I'm saying like that was a huge accomplishment for a team that hadn't made the postseason in over a decade.
And the Phillies flat out
coming
lost,
off an all-time high, and then we lose the first five of six games of the season, mm-hmm. and we're right back to that low thinking we're not going to be able to follow this up. We do that, we get back to the NLCS, we get that two-game lead, and then we go right back down to that low, just like the beginning of the season. Lose the exact same, right? We lose the first five of six.
There were lots of parallels between last year and this year.
Yeah.
Especially with that Braves series, kind of almost the exact same story. Game one, the Phillies won. Game two, they just lost in the last innings. The Braves came back and win. Game three was dominant. Game four, the Phillies just pulled out. Except in game four in 2022, the Phillies kind of blew them out. But it's just so many parallels, and it's incredible to think about. But I want to talk – let's stick to 2023. As this is our last episode of this season until we look ahead to the future. This is the last time we're looking back in the past. This series flipped in game three. When Craig Kimbrel took that mound in the ninth inning, this series flipped. When he gave up the walk-off base hit to Ketel Marte, failed to get he only got one out in the inning, gave up bases loaded, gave up the base winning hit, and then game four, the Diamondbacks tied it up when Craig Kimbrel went out again. And then game five, things started to look better. And then, but I think this momentum shifted in game three, and the Diamondbacks took it up. When Garrett Stubbs said, you know, we're going to go party out in that pool, like beeline to the pool, like the attaboy against Bryce Harper, that fueled the Diamondbacks. And Garrett Stubbs should know better, and he should keep his mouth shut. I think it was an overreaction because he said, if we win this series, we're going out there, not when we win this series. But still, you got to keep your mouth shut there. You saw it with the attaboy. You saw it. You know, it's a way of feel petite. Game three, when Kimbrel gave up that hit, is really where this series faltered. But the Phillies still had opportunity. They had two chances to win this series at home. And it really relies on This series comes down to Trey Turner, Bryce Harper, Gabe Castellanos failing to hit. Flat out.
I agree. Ben, I got a question for you. So, looking at the season as a whole, considering every aspect of it, would you say that the Phillies exceeded, met, or failed to meet their expectations that we established prior to the season?
Well, I think the regular season was about where I expected, around 90 wins, get that fourth spot in the National League. I thought they would maybe have the 5 or 6 seed because I thought the Mets would have a much better season than they did, but 4 seed is really right where I expected them. And then my expectation for this team was to get back in the World Series. They did not do that.
So slightly below, would you say?
I would say slightly below, but I think the way they went out and the team they went out against, this team failed expectations. They're a much better team on paper than the Arizona Diamondbacks. You saw it in games 1 and 2. You saw it in game 5 where they killed Zach Gallen again. The Phillies hit their aces very well. Zach Gallen and Merrill Kelly, they hit well in games 1 and 2. Game 5, they hit Gallen well again. In the game 6, they couldn't really hit Merrill Kelly. But this was... It's hard. It's still 2 days removed from game 7. I still can't wrap my mind around how they went out and played in that game 7. Like, to go out and play how they did in a crowd. It was a very good crowd. I mean, if anybody was fired up, you should hear Dan Baker's pregame introductions. Those were incredible. But it was just first game 7 in franchise history, and they do. I mean, if we're talking about the Philadelphia Phillies, and if I need to explain to someone to describe the Philadelphia Phillies franchise, I am showing them this series. And you get out to that early start. It was an incredible start. And then the bullpen falters in games 3 and 4. They look promising in game 5, and then they come home highly favored to win. They should have won, and flat out didn't produce. So
yeah, so I do I think you summed it up pretty well. This series, the expectation, in my opinion, was to trample the Diamondbacks. You had no reason not to. The Diamondbacks are pretty strong to Phillies, given that they are a team who got hot at the right time. Now, I don't think it's realistic to say that the Phillies' expectation for the season as a whole would be to win the World Series, because I truthfully think there were 10 to 12 teams in baseball who would have made that same set that same optimistic precedent. So I would say that this was about what I think this team is, the quality of this team. When I look at other teams, right, like the Braves, the Dodgers, the Astros, I think actually were a little bit under where they should have been this year. Or some other forces in the American League, like the Tampa Bay Rays. This is where I feel like the Phillies are right now. So I would say that season as a whole, they met their expectations. They're about where I think it's fair to place them. But this series was definitely disappointing. This should have been an easy route for the Phillies to exceed those expectations, like you said. But I think failing to see that route and to take advantage of that easy route is what really puts a damper on the season as a whole.
And I don't like when we make goals for the season, because the goal for the season is always to win the World Series.
Right.
Whether you're tanking, whether you're the best team in baseball, any sport, any profession, always to be on top. It's not realistic for every team. I mean, this Phillies team, it might have been a bit very realistic, but every season, and I'm not going to sit here and be like Giannis Antetokounmpo, it's never stepped in the right direction. No. The Phillies failed at their overall goal this year. Expectation-wise, and my expectation was reigning National League champion. They had the team to do it. They had the manager to do it. Everything was lined up for them to do it. They just couldn't execute when it really mattered. And you saw it in those last couple of innings. Trey Turner failing to bunt the ball. Come on. It's bunting. I know how to bunt, and I haven't played baseball in about, 2 years maybe? I bet your son could have bunt that ball. Like, come on, Trey. And then you fail to get it on base when you needed to in that at-bat, and then Bryce Harper later in the game, in the seventh inning, misses a 96-mile-per-hour fastball practically right down the heart of the plate, which he hit in games five of the NLCS. It was the same pitch, 3 miles per hour more. He hit that ball out of the ballpark for bedlam at the bank. He could have had more bedlam if he hits that ball not just out of the ballpark. He could have gotten that on base and score a run, leaving runners on first and second. He misses that ball. Nick Castellanos literally fell off the face of the earth after his first at-bat of the NLCS. He did not record a single base hit. He was like 0 for 32 or something around that line. I mean, that is unbelievable. And I hated Rob Thompson's answer at the end of the season. Horrible answer when they said, well, how do you feel about Nick's fall-off? And he goes, that's Nick. No, it's not. Nick Castellanos all season has been one of the most consistent hitters in this lineup. He's been probably been the best hitter in this lineup all season. And to
Bryce Harper?
All season. Harper didn't play all season.
Okay.
And like just to go out and say that's Nick, that's first of all, it's the wrong message. Second of all, it's not true. Nick Castellanos has been consistent, pretty much been hitting the ball all year. If you want to say your most consistent player in the regular season was Bryson Stott, fair. But Nick Castellanos really took a step from last season, and to say that's Nick going 0 for 30 something, horrible answer, and just not true. Because no player in baseball really goes 0 for 30 in the NLCS, other than, I guess, Nick Castellanos in this situation. Especially for how hot they were going into the series.
Yeah, I agree with that because I understand that there are going to be series where certain guys don't play well, you know, maybe a month where a certain guy doesn't play well because baseball's a game. I mean, this sounds so cliche, so baseball bad-ishy. But, you know, mistakes are going to happen. It's a game of failure. Physical mistakes are acceptable, all that garbage, right? Which really isn't garbage. I think it's just said a lot. But there's a difference between failing more than succeeding and having physical struggles than whatever happened in the last three games of the series. Like the 1-for-20-whatever that Schwarber, Turner, Castellanos, and Harper were in those final three games.
Two games.
That's a different level that I think goes from being acceptable to unacceptable. Like, the Phillies won this series because they had a couple hits in there, and maybe, let's say Castellanos still didn't record that hit, and maybe he contributed with some walks or some stolen bases or some huge plays in the outfield, but these guys really didn't do much.
So it was...
Turner made some errors.
Yep.
Right? Harper had a couple, not huge misplays in the field, but there was a throw that was a little bit wonky. From what I heard, it's just like these guys, the biggest issue here isn't that the sheer number of, what was it, 1-for-20, was it 1-for-21 in the final three games?
So it was the final two games, Schwarber, Turner, Harper, and Castellanos all combined went 1-for-28 in games 6 and 7.
Yeah.
That right there is roughly $92,834,615 of the 2023 Phillies, $260,726,209 payroll.
Yeah, so like I said, it's not the number. It's not the 1-for-28. It's the issue. It's the fact that they did absolutely nothing. Like, if you calculated the WAR for those four guys
nothing
over those two games, it should be -8. They each should get a -1 wins above replacement for those two games.
Yep,
it should be a collective -8 value right there because they did nothing. Absolutely zero.
Castellanos went 0-for-23 after his first at-bat, striking out 11 times.
I think the hood needs to go back up.
What else? Also, I want to talk about Aaron Nola's start in Game 6 a little bit because, God, he was terrible. I mean, really, when you have to pitch well there, and he's pitched so well in the postseason, he has been so good for this team, their most reliable starter in the postseason. And
what about Wheeler?
He was better than Wheeler going up until Game 6. Lower his Wheeler gave up a few more runs than Nola did. Nola was just flat out, like, I think he gave up, other than game six, like one run all postseason. But he goes out there and just absolutely collapses. And he was so good in clinching games, and he was horrendous. And now that is his, might be his last start as a Philadelphia Philly. We'll get to that in the next episode, but
we will. Ben, so here's my issue with all of this. So Nola goes out there and struggles, right? From what I saw, nothing changed. Like, he had to be doing something, because even the outs that he got, they were pounding the ball. Like, in the, I think, because that was one of the, I did watch that portion of the series, and in that start where Nola, it was his second start of the series, right, where he faltered.
Yes.
And, I mean, his pitches were okay. They were good. I wouldn't say they were great. The movement, the stuff, but he left them, the control wasn't there. He didn't have all of his usual bite. And nothing seemed to change. Like, the Diamondbacks were consistently pounding the ball hard. Even in, like, they had some really, really hard flyouts I can think of to left field and center field. Yep. That still didn't make it look like Nola was super sharp. So I don't know if the Diamondbacks were picking up on something he was doing, or if they, maybe I would assume Nola was tipping his pitches if that were the case. But if it was a mechanical thing that was making him struggle with location, nothing changed. And I think that is something that the coaches need to recognize, because Nola's not the guy who's going to be able to go in the dugout and diagnose his own problems without the help of other players and coaches. But I saw nothing that changed. We shouldn't see the same issues persisting in professional players for 4 to 5 straight innings. That was my biggest issue, with that start, is that there was the same struggle going on. Like, there are some days where players are just not going to have it, right? They're not going to be able to locate. They're going to make adjustments. But I didn't hear any of any interviews where he was like, I was doing this, I was doing that. But I don't think that in that big of a game, or really in any game for that matter, you can just say, yeah, it wasn't working, can be. Like, that can't be an answer.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean.
But it was strange. Like,
yeah,
it was like a complete change of character. He went from having unhittable stuff to them making hard contact in every direction.
Yeah, and speaking about unhittable stuff, you talk about the drop-off of your boy Craig Kimbrel. He was so good. An all-star. In the first half of the season, got his 400th save, and then around September, he just completely was terrible. He was horrible this postseason, especially in the NLCS against the Diamondbacks. Blew two games. The Phillies win both of those games. They sweep the Diamondbacks. The Phillies had opportunities to possibly win games four, to clinch in game four and game five, if Kimbrel either doesn't pitch in those situations. And you can confirm this, that I was saying before the postseason, Kimbrel should not be in that late inning role and should be replaced with Jeff Hoffman. You can, and I said it on the pod, it is on air, like, it's out there. I said it multiple times that I don't trust Craig Kimbrel in big situations. And if he pitched the most innings of his old career, and it proved true.
Yeah, so that's super tricky. There's the performance aspect of it, and obviously leading up to the postseason, coming from Kimbrel, it was definitely subpar. His velocity dropped. He was not locating his pitches as well. But there's also the aspect of trust and loyalty, but because Kimbrel was great all season. I mean, outside of the first and the last months, he was electric. He was an all-star. He got his 400th save. He had like 2 months where he allowed like a combined 3 or 4, maybe 5 runs, which is a crazy number. I mean, there was a point where he would come in regardless of the situation, and you knew you were getting a shutdown inning. And it's hard to justify, like, oh, yeah, this guy has struggled for 3 weeks, so we're just going to ignore everything that he's done for the past 4 months prior. And that's what really, really makes these situations tricky. It's, in a way, it's very, very similar to the Taiwan Walker argument, which is that he should have gotten an opportunity to pitch because he had 15 wins. He has had some 7-8 inning starts. He's been semi-consistently very, very average throughout the season, and they're paying him a fair amount of money. The arguments there are very, very similar, right? This is a first ballot Hall of Famer in Craig Kimbrel. And while I don't disagree with you, I understand why he was still in that role, but it's definitely an opaque situation.
I don't know.
It also messes up the structure of the entire bullpen, right? Because you remove Kimbrel from that spot. Now you need to use someone in a tight situation that you normally wouldn't be able to use. That means that your eighth inning guy becomes your seventh inning guy. Sorry, opposite. Your seventh inning guy becomes your eighth inning guy. And that means that the depth of your bullpen just got a little bit depleted there. So I know we need to wrap this up, but where would you have been comfortable with Kimbrel coming out of the bullpen?
A lower leverage, like middle of the lineup, like 5, 6, 7, 8, like in either the 6th or 7th inning. Like I would kind of replace him with Hoffman's regular season role. Just a quick flip-flop. But really, I feel like we've been doubting the Diamondbacks a little bit. The Diamondbacks played an incredible series. The Arizona Diamondbacks, I'm biting my tongue on what I said in the NLCS preview. They're the real deal. They are a very good team. They're very well managed. Torrey Lovello is a very good manager. Corbin Carroll, he had a horrible series until game 7 where he went 3-for-4. And Ketel Marte is unbelievable. They're a good team. They don't have incredible star power. They play in a horrible stadium. But they're a good team. And I'm not going to sit here and make excuses. The Diamondbacks outplayed the Phillies. Flat out. The Diamondbacks looked like the 1972 team, and the Phillies looked like the 1984 and 1978 team. I'm not going to sit here and make excuses. That's what happened. The Phillies got outplayed by the Diamondbacks. Rob Thompson, did he have the best series? No. There were some times he could have maybe pinch hit for Johan Rojas. Not use Craig Kimbrel or Ryan Kirkring, who also had a bad series. But the Phillies didn't get outmanaged. The umpires didn't, even though they weren't great, they were horrible. They were not the reason the Phillies lost the series. The Phillies lost the series because they couldn't pitch when they needed to get good outings or good innings, they didn't. When they needed to get on base and get hits, they didn't. And the big four in this lineup, mostly Castellanos, Harper, and Turner, completely failed to execute. So the Phillies got flat out outplayed by the Diamondbacks, and there's a bunch of what ifs. Like, what if the Phillies win the series? What if Bryce Harper hits that ball? What if Nick Castellanos doesn't go cold? What if Craig Kimbrel doesn't come in the inning? It's just, it happened. There's nothing we can do about it. We have to sit here until now. March 30th, and I'm just waiting for opening day tickets to go on sale so I can be back in that ballpark and root on my Phillies, because I am already feeling that seasonal depression.
That's very, very fair. Now, of course, you've got the James Harden Sixers tonight, so don't get too disappointed.
He's not even playing.
Right, James Harden Sixers. So
I guess that's kind of a better version of the Sixers, honestly.
Might be. I'll tell you one thing. I know, like I said, I know this has to, you need to put a bow tie on this, but one thing that I appreciated this series from Rob Thompson is that he stuck to his plan. Mm-hmm. I felt like under Joe Girardi, we saw a lot of, it's very all over the place. Some days he'd be like, the metrics told me to do this. And other days he'd be like, yeah, it just felt like the right decision, right? Like Thompson has shown some things when he took over on, I want to say June the 2nd. Of 2022 that he's always going to do. He's going to trust his young guys, right? He did that with Rojas and Kirkering. Was it too much? A little bit. I think there were some very questionable Kirkering moves. I actually think that the Kirkering decisions were more egregious than Rojas, right? You know, you can't remove Rojas from the lineup just because he had a bad postseason. He hit 300 in the regular season. If he hit like 240, 250 in the regular season, I could see that. But he hit 300 in the regular season. You can't just say, oh, he's had a bad 2 weeks. We're kicking him from the lineup. Kirkering was a little egregious, but he stuck with his young guys. Stop played every day. You have to appreciate that out of a guy like Thompson. We knew he had a ton of trust in Kimbrel. He made that clear during the regular season. He made it clear during the postseason. He wasn't jumpy. He didn't act all crazy instinct, trying to overmanage. I think Thompson stuck with what he has been doing, and it didn't work. So I can't blame this on Thompson.
No, it's absolutely not Topper's fault. I have another thing to say. It's absolutely not Topper's fault. But this, going into the offseason, we'll have a offseason preview after the World Series ends, which I want to talk about a little bit. We have a couple more minutes to wrap this up. But this is the team. I mean, there's not going to be any major changes other than maybe re-signing Aaron Nola and Rhys Hoskins. Definitely some bullpen adjustments, but this is the team. This is the lineup. This is what the Phillies are going to stick with for the next however many years. Maybe I think that Schwarber's going into his third year of his contract for another 2 years. This is going to be the lineup. This is it. This is the team. They just didn't get the job done in 2023. I don't know how many prime Harper years you're going to get left, because this is one of the best Harper years. Not sure how many years of prime Wheeler you're going to get. Not sure if Trey Turner's going to, you know, play how he did last year, or maybe he'll make an adjustment. You know, this was Castellanos, one of his best years of his career. You're never going to know what you're going to get from Kyle Schwarber. This is really, if they were going to do it any year, it was going to be this year. Everything fell in place for this team this year. They had the chance to overpower the Diamondbacks and get to the World Series, and they didn't. But if any team was going to win the World Series, it's probably this one. And they just couldn't get past Arizona. So,
yeah. All right, Ben, before we go into our outro, got to give the viewers some incentive to watch the next episode. So you are going to give me, and then I'm going to give you, a bold prediction for the offseason. It can be as general or as specific as you would like it to be. One statement, one sentence. Don't elaborate. Just give me one sentence. I might even write it down.
Rhys Hoskins goes to the Cleveland Guardians.
LOL. the Phillies signed two major free agents. Two. And by major, I'm going to rephrase. The Phillies signed two relevant free agents. So, for instance, yesterday, I saw on the MLB transactions wire that the Cardinals signed Buddy Kennedy from the Oakland Athletics. That's not major. Major means a major league player who will likely be rostered on the 40-man or the 26-man roster for a majority of the season. Like, I would consider Matt Strom a major free agent signing. So I'm going to say they get two of those this offseason. And so I think we're both pretty familiar with the names.
Does this count as re-signings or just signings? Like,
they're just signings in general. Re-signings.
So they could be Rhys Hoskins or Nola?
Could be Rhys Hoskins or Nola. There will be two major league players.
We're going to get to that in the next pod. But we never shout out SeatGeek in this pod. Thank you to SeatGeek for speaking. Make sure you use code Philly Sports Support at SeatGeek. Colin, we will talk after the World Series, but for now, we have a Texas Rangers Arizona Diamondbacks World Series. It's going to be the worst World Series in MLB history. Who's winning? And do we care?
The Arizona Diamondbacks, because that would make me feel slightly better.
Make me feel worse, because I know we could win the World Series then. But all right.
Well, yeah.
There you go. So thank you all for right, watching. Well, What was this episode? Was this 40?
Yes.
Three. Thank you for listening to episode 43. We will talk to you after the World Series. Go follow us on social media. Go Eagles. We'll talk to you in a few weeks. Thank you for listening and watching. Bye.